So students, in the last few video lectures, we already have discussed about pure translatory motion and pure rotational motion. In pure translatory motion, all the particles will have same displacement, same velocity, same acceleration. Therefore, we will be calculating velocity of the center of mass, force acting on the center of mass, momentum exhibited by center of mass, law of conservation of linear momentum is valid, and we can find out whatever the unknown quantities it is. It is pure translatory motion. Whereas in case of pure rotational motion, the body will be rotated with respect to one fixed axis. This is axis of rotation, and a particle here will have radius r, and the particle which is here radius have r1, and this is r2. So each and every particle will execute circular motion with respect to one fixed axis with different axis of, like, with different radius of curvature. So in pure rotational motion, we will be calculating moment of inertia with respect to fixed axis, and then we will calculate torque, angular momentum, angular displacement, angular velocity, angular acceleration, relation between torque and angular momentum. So those we will be doing in case of pure rotational motion. Now let us see the third case, where the object, which is a sphere, and this sphere has mass m, and if this sphere is rolling on the horizontal surface, if the sphere is rolling on the horizontal surface, what you could observe, the particle which is at the center, this particle will exactly come to this position. And this particle is also coming to this position. This particle is also coming to this position, but it is not in the straight line path, right? The particle at this position would come to rotation in this particular path. So the particle which is at the center, exactly it would come towards the center with a straight line path. What's your observation? It is that some particles, like the particle which is here, it will be coming to this new position like this. Similarly, the particle which is here, it comes like this. So some particles of this object is purely translational, is having purely translational motion. Some particles of this object is having purely rotational motion, right? So therefore, rolling motion, we call such type of motion as rolling motion. Rolling motion is the combination of translational motion and rotational motion. Rolling motion is the combination of translational motion and rotational motion. This is number one. And this is number two. Number three, which is the sum of these two. So in order to discuss about rolling motion, you need to have clear-cut understanding about translatory motion and as well as rotational motion. Because rolling motion is the combination of translatory motion and as well as rotational motion. So when we are dealing with translatory motion, we will be calculating velocity of the center of mass. Likewise, when we are dealing with rotational motion, we will be calculating angular velocity. Therefore, every particle in rolling body has translational and rotational motion. Therefore, the velocity of this particle, velocity of every particle here in the case of rolling motion, it is a sum of velocity of translational motion plus velocity of rotational motion. So every particle in rolling motion will have two velocities. One due to translational motion and the other one due to rotational motion. Therefore, In order to calculate velocity of the particle in rolling motion, we need to calculate velocity of the particle, which is in translatory and as well as rotational. So if you are able to calculate this and if you sum up in the form of vector, you will be getting net velocity of that particle. So every particle has its own velocity, which is different from other. Therefore, it is mandatory to learn about rolling motion separately than that of translatory motion and as well as rotational motion. In this video session, we are going to learn details about rolling motion, how to calculate velocity of a rolling body, how to calculate velocity of the particle which is in rolling motion, and what are the different types of rolling motions which we have. Those we will be discussing in this video session. So let us consider an object of mass m. Let me take, this is an object of mass m, and this body is rolling. It is rolling on horizontal surface. Now imagine one particle which is at the center. The particle which is at the center is having velocity purely translational. The particle which is traveling, like exactly it is at, if it is at the center, the particle which is at the center is having purely translatory motion. Now let us imagine the particle which is at this position at the bottom here. Okay, the particle which is at the bottom, in order to, like when the whole system is coming in forward direction, the motion of that particle would be denoted with this blue color line. Ultimately it comes to this position. Right? What is total distance traveled by the particle? It is circumference of that particular sphere. So distance traveled by particle in rolling motion of a sphere is circumference of the circular path. So it is literally executing circular path with respect to one fixed axis. So particle, it is starting at one point, say this is A, and after some time, the same particle comes to this new position B. After some time, the same particle comes to this new position C. So particle is traveling in the curved path. So therefore, you can write total distance traveled. Distance traveled is equal to circumference of the circular path, that is 2 pi r. And the time taken to travel from here to here is time period. Time period capital T. Therefore, when we are dealing with velocity of such particles, it is 2 pi r divided by T, velocity of particle in rolling motion is 2 pi r divided by capital T, right? So what is 2 pi by capital T? 2 pi by capital T is omega into r, since 2 pi by capital T is equal to omega, where omega is angular velocity. So it is completely making an angle of 2 pi radian. Therefore, omega is equal to 2 pi by T. So hence, rotational motion, this particle is executing rotational motion, and its rotational velocity Vr can be written as r omega. Along with that, this particle is also having translational motion, which is in forward direction. So therefore, translational motion is equal to velocity of center of mass, because all the particles will have same velocity as that of the particle which is at center of mass. Therefore, translational velocity of the object is equal to velocity of center of mass. So all the particles in the rolling body will have same velocity as that of center of mass. So I can now write, for any given particle, velocity of particle in rolling motion is v bar is equal to vr bar plus vc bar. And v bar is equal to, what is rotational velocity? You can take it as r omega bar plus translational velocity. It is velocity of center of mass. This is how you can find out velocity of each particle, which is the sum of rotational velocity and as well as translational velocity. So whenever you want to calculate velocity of the particle of rolling body, simply we will be taking this vector notation, vector sum of rotational velocity and as well as translational velocity of that particle. Yeah. So as we are dealing with rolling motion, so rolling motion is combination of translational motion and as well as rotational motion. Now, if we are considering a particle, that particle will have two velocities, translational and as well as rotational. So let us consider a sphere where we are taking four particles, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this is pure translational. Pure translational. So for a body which is in pure translational, all the particles of body will have same velocity as the whole system is moving with velocity equal to velocity of center of mass. This particle at 3 will have velocity equal to velocity of center of mass. Particle at 4 also do have velocity equal to velocity of center of mass in the same direction. Likewise, particle at 1 position and particle at position 2 also. All these particles will have same translational velocity. So that is pure translational. And you are combining that with pure rotational. In case of pure rotational, let us imagine that the total system is rotated with angular velocity omega, and it is about this fixed axis. This is fixed axis. Axis is at the center, and the particle which is at the center does not have any velocity. And if you observe carefully, the particle which is at position 2, its velocity is in this direction. The particle which is at position 1, its velocity is equal to minus vcm, because at that instant the particle is about to go left side. Likewise, the particle at this position 4, its velocity is downward, and the particle which is at position 3, it is exactly equal to velocity of center of mass. So different particles at different positions are possessing velocities which are different. So we are getting velocity of the particle at position 1 as v1 dash, likewise v2 dash, v3 dash and v4 dash. So when we are dealing with the particle which is at position 1, this is position 1. Due to translational motion, its velocity is vcm, right side, and due to rotational motion, its velocity is left side, minus vcm. If you combine those two, what is net velocity of the particle at that position? Net velocity of the particle at that position is equal to zero, because translational motion velocity is right side, rotational motion velocity is left side, and both magnitudes are same. Therefore, they both get cancelled with each other. As a result, the particle which is in contact with the horizontal surface, its velocity is taken to be zero, right? Because the directions are different. It is right side, it is left side. If you add these two, what you are getting here for this particle, velocity it is becoming zero. Likewise, let us consider a particle which is at position 2. Translational velocity it is right side, rotational velocity is upward. The resultant of those two you can sum up like this. You can take, this is one vector, this is another vector. Sum of these two vectors is this V2 bar, which is making an angle of 45 degrees with respect to x-axis. Similarly, come to position of the particle, which is at 3. Translational velocity is VCM and rotational velocity is also equal to VCM. Therefore, the particle which is at position 3, it is a sum of this velocity and this velocity, which is equal to 2 times velocity of center of mass. It is 2 times velocity of center of mass, that is at position 3. And coming to fourth position, see, translational velocity is right side and the rotational velocity is downward. Sum of these two vectors will be in this direction. This is V4, which makes an angle of 45 degrees with respect to horizontal. Now clearly you can understand that every particle in case of rolling motion will have some net velocity, which is the combination of translational velocity and as well as rotational velocity. And rotational velocity can be written as R into omega. Translational velocity is equal to velocity of the center of mass. This we already have learned. And the direction of the particles of the rolling body, the direction of velocity of the particle at different positions is different. But one thing you can observe, the particle which is in contact with the horizontal surface, its relative velocity is equal to zero, right? So the particle which is in contact with horizontal surface has zero relative velocity. Zero relative velocity. That means Vc minus Vr is equal to zero. What is Vc minus Vr? It is Vcr. That means velocity of the translational velocity with respect to rotational velocity. That is relative velocity. It is Vc minus Vr is equal to zero, since magnitude of Vc and magnitude of Vr are equal there. So such type of motion where the particle which is in contact with the horizontal surface, if its velocity is becoming equal to zero, it means that this type of motion is called pure rolling motion. It is pure rolling. It is pure rolling. So how can you classify rolling as pure rolling? If the relative velocity of the particle which is in contact with the ground, if it is equal to zero, then we say that body is in pure rolling motion, right? Now, likewise, we also have condition. So first condition is that Vc is equal to Vr. Second condition is that Vc greater than Vr. Third condition is that Vc less than Vr. Three possible conditions we have. Vc is equal to Vr. Vc is equal to Vr. We call it as pure rolling. If Vc is not equal to Vr, it is called impure rolling. It is called impure rolling. And in impure rolling, we have two possible cases. What are they? Translational velocity magnitude is greater than rotational velocity magnitude, or translational velocity magnitude is less than rotational velocity magnitude. So when we deal with rolling motion, the rolling motion can be two types. One is pure rolling, where translational velocity magnitude is equal to rotational velocity magnitude and VCR will be equal to zero. The velocity of the particle which is in contact with the ground, its relative velocity is zero. Whereas in case of impure rolling, the particle which is in contact with the ground, its relative velocity is not equal to zero. In such cases, there will be two possibilities. The translational velocity magnitude may be greater than that of rotational velocity, whereas translational velocity magnitude is less than that of rotational velocity. So impure rolling can be rolling with the slipping or rolling without slipping. Slip, the rotational motion or the rolling body will undergo slipping. So now we will learn what is pure rolling and how is impure rolling different from pure rolling, and what about rolling friction acting upon the rolling body. So as we already have discussed, every particle in rolling body will have two velocities, translational and as well as rotational. And in case of pure rolling, we already have learned that Vc magnitude is equal to Vr magnitude, which is r omega. Therefore, Vc is equal to r omega. Vc minus r omega is equal to zero. That means Vcr is equal to zero. Right? So the particle which is in contact with the ground at this position, this particle Vcr is equal to zero. Right? So as Vcr, that means the particle which is at translational mode, which is at the contact with ground, that particle will have no relative motion, right? So if there is no relative motion, friction does not act. Therefore, rolling friction will be equal to zero because there is no rolling friction in this case. Rolling friction is zero as there is no relative velocity of the particle which is in contact with the ground, right? So friction does not exist in such case. So in pure rolling, in pure rolling motion, rolling friction will be equal to zero. Rolling friction is equal to zero. There is no frictional motion. And here, when the body is in pure rolling motion, if at all there exists, if at all there is a frictional force, that would be static friction but not rolling friction. Okay. So in this case, in pure rolling, remember that in pure rolling, no dynamic friction exists. No dynamic friction, that means kinetic friction will be equal to zero, and friction, if exists, it will be only static friction. Static friction, right? Now, if F external is equal to zero, then static friction is also equal to zero. If F external is not equal to zero, then static friction is not equal to zero. But in this case, rolling friction will be equal to zero. In this case also, rolling friction is equal to zero. So therefore, you should remember, in case of pure rolling, the body does not have rolling friction. The magnitude of rolling friction is zero. Therefore, it does not offer any frictional force. Therefore, always we prefer, in decreasing frictional force, we always prefer rolling motion. That's the reason why we will be using small ball bearings in between two contacting surfaces in order to decrease the friction rolling friction tend to be zero when you are taking two surfaces like this. Like you will be taking one surface. This is one surface and this is another surface. And instead of moving one upon the other directly, what generally people do is there will be one ball bearing taken here. There will be one ball bearing taken here. There will be one ball bearing taken here. So because at this position, rolling friction is equal to zero. Therefore, the friction between two surfaces, magnitude, its magnitude tend to zero. Rolling friction is decreased in a drastic way. That's the reason why one way of decreasing frictional force is to roll a body rather than to slide. Instead of taking two surfaces and sliding one upon the other, we will be taking two ball bearings in between these two surfaces and we will just slide upon them. As a result, it becomes pure rolling. In pure rolling, frictional magnitude is very, very, very less. That means, of course, it is negligible. That's what pure rolling is very advantageous in decreasing the magnitude of friction.